Books on Tape presents America's First Dynasty, The Adamses, 1735 to 1918, by Richard Brookhiser, read by Dan Cashman. Introduction. Chapter 1. The first time anyone asked a member of the Adams family about his famous ancestors, she was joking. In April 1778, John Adams, lately of the Continental Congress, arrived in Bordeaux, France, to represent the new nation as a diplomat. His second day ashore, he was introduced to polite conversation at European dinner tables. "Mr. Adams," a pretty young woman asked him, "by your name, I conclude you are descended from the first man and woman." Did he know of any family tradition that might explain how Adam and Eve found out the art of lying together? "I believe at first I blushed," wrote Adams in his diary that night, "but I was determined not to be disconcerted." He replied that a physical quality, like magnetism, caused any pair of Adams and Eves that drew within a striking distance to fly together like the needle to the pole. "It is a very happy shock," the lady said. John went on to assignments in Holland and Britain, as well as honors and offices at home, and soon enough, Adamses were being questioned about their forebears in earnest. In 1795, John Quincy Adams, John's eldest son, was in London on a diplomatic mission of his own, and met George III, the king against whom his father had rebelled. His Majesty asked if all the Adamses belonged to Massachusetts. An attendant minister told them they did, whereupon he asked John Quincy if his father was now governor. "No, sir, he's vice president of the United States." "Aye," said the king, "and he cannot hold both offices at the same time." If the new nation was still only dimly understood, its first dynasty was already known. 20 years later, John Quincy was back in London, this time as American minister to Great Britain, and had a similar conversation with George III's son, the Prince Regent, who ruled during his father's final illness. After they exchanged greetings, the Prince Regent asked John Quincy if he was related to Mr. Adams, who had formerly been the minister from the United States here. "I said I was his son." One member of the House of Hanover was preparing to succeed his father on the throne of England. A member of the House of Adams was following in his father's footsteps. John Quincy went on to be Secretary of State, President, and, as a congressman, a scourge of slavery and its political representatives. While he was in the White House, he hosted a dinner for Lafayette, the aged hero of the Revolution, who had met him and his father almost 40 years earlier. At dinner, Lafayette pointed to 19-year-old Charles Francis, the president's youngest son, and the man who would be most famous among the third generation of famous Adamses, and solemnly asked the First Lady to see to it that he never entertained thoughts of becoming president save by the free choice of the people. Charles Francis never entertained such thoughts, nor did the people ever choose him. But in 1848, he succeeded his father in the affections of anti-slavery men when he was nominated to be the vice presidential candidate of the Free Soil Party. "Yes, sir, we want him," said a delegate from Wisconsin. "There he is, with the crape on his hat." John Quincy had died 6 months earlier. Charles Francis, still in mourning, was treated as if he bore his transmigrated spirit. Not everyone viewed the Adams family history favorably. Henry Adams, Charles Francis' third son, moved to Washington, D.C. after the Civil War to represent the fourth generation of Adamses there as a political journalist rather than a politician. One of his targets, Senator Timothy Howe of Wisconsin, declared that Henry belonged to a family in which statesmanship is preserved by propagation, like color in the leaf of the begonia, perpetuating resemblance by perpetual change. "To be abused by a senator is my highest ambition," Henry wrote a friend. "My only regret is that I cannot afford to hire a senator to abuse me permanently." Henry wrote with the enthusiasm of youth. He would go on observing senators with diminishing humor for another 48 years. By the end of Henry's life, the Adamses had been center stage, or in the front row of the orchestra, for almost a century and a half. They had been present at the creation, not, French banter aside, of the world, but of the country, and at many of its pivotal scenes. The United States is formally an egalitarian nation. The Declaration of Independence, John Adams was on the drafting committee, states that all men are created equal. Yet political families weave through its history. In the 2000 presidential election, Vice President Al Gore Jr., son of Senator Albert Gore, ran against George W. Bush, son of President George Bush, and grandson of Senator Prescott Bush. The wife of the outgoing president, Hillary Clinton, became a senator. One of the signers of the Declaration was Benjamin Harrison, an indolent, luxurious, heavy gentleman, John Adams called him, a charter member of the Virginia gentry. His son, William Henry Harrison, became president, as did William Henry's grandson, Benjamin Harrison. Franklin Roosevelt was Theodore Roosevelt's fifth cousin. Eleanor Roosevelt, her maiden name, was T.R.'s niece. One of Henry Adams's friends and intellectual foils was Henry Cabot Lodge, who became a senator from Massachusetts. Lodge's great-grandfather, George Cabot, had been a senator from Massachusetts and an enemy of John and John Quincy Adams. Lodge's grandson, also named Henry Cabot Lodge, became yet another Massachusetts senator until he was beaten by John Kennedy and a fresher dynasty. Political families regularly flare to national prominence or sink to lower levels, like the Tafts. Or they keep percolating along as local fixtures. In 2000, the representative of the 11th Congressional District of New Jersey was Rodney Frelinghuysen, the first political Frelinghuysen, Frederick, represented New Jersey in the Continental Congress in 1778, the year John Adams went to France. Political families pass on inclination as well as opportunity. The founding Poles give their children prominence and contacts, while the talk around the dinner table and the family pictures on the wall or in the scrapbooks provide inspiration and example. John Adams expected these hereditary concentrations of power. They had marked the relatively free institutions of the colonies and would survive independence. "Go into every village in New England," he wrote in 1787, "and you will find that the office of Justice of the Peace has descended from generation to generation in three or four families at most. No family will ever be as famous as the Adamses, whose role in the founding gives them a leg up even on the Roosevelts. But as long as there are elections, people will vote for candidates whose names they recognize. It is the tribute democracy pays to aristocracy." The Adamses also define themselves as a meritocracy. They inspired their descendants to hold office, but they also required them to work for it. They did not expect fame and power to come to them by virtue of their birth alone. They trained themselves to live up to their birth, and then they expected fame and power to come to them. John Quincy Adams' parents told him that his career should reflect his advantages. If it did not, It would be due to his laziness, slovenliness, and obstinacy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.